The topic of today's lecture is study of disymmetry in allenes, biphenyls, spiro compounds, and we will also study helical chirality, means chirality which is due to the helical shape. And in this topic we will be encountering some molecules which do not contain any chiral centers, yet the molecule shows optical activity. So in other words, we can say that this topic is about compounds which show chirality without the presence of any chiral centers. So you know, there are various molecules which do not contain asymmetric centers. There are no asymmetric centers, or there are no chiral centers present, but still the molecule is chiral, and hence they show optical activity. And in such compounds, there are two perpendicular planes, neither of which can be bisected by a plane of symmetry. Means there are various molecules which lack any chiral center, yet they are optically active. And in all of these compounds, in most of these compounds, in fact, there are two perpendicular planes, and neither of those planes can be bisected by a plane of symmetry, means they lack a plane of symmetry. And if either plane could be so bisected, the molecule would be superimposable on its mirror image, and the molecule will be optically inactive. So these are some of the examples of molecules which do not contain any chiral centers, yet the molecule is optically active. But for that purpose, these are biphenyl compounds. They are known as biphenyls. Two phenyl rings are joined by a carbon-carbon single bond. And for optical activity to exist in these molecules, these ortho substituents, they have to be large groups, they have to be bulky groups. That is one condition. Second condition is that each of these rings should be unsymmetrically substituted. If any of these two rings is symmetrically substituted, then the molecule would have a plane of symmetry, it will have a disymmetric plane, and the molecule will be optically inactive. And this indicates the angle between the planes of the two rings. And in this case, the angle between the planes of two rings is, it's zero. Means both these rings are in one plane. And in this case here, the angle between the planes of two rings is 90 degree, means the plane of this ring is perpendicular to the plane of this ring. That's why the angle between them is 90 degree. So so there compounds like biphenyls, allenes, and spiro compounds, they show chirality due to these disymmetric perpendicular planes. So the chirality or the optical activity in such compounds is because of the presence of disymmetric perpendicular planes. We will first talk about biphenyls. So biphenyls, they contain four large groups in the ortho positions, and they as a result of those large groups, they cannot freely rotate about the central bond joining the two rings because of steric hindrance or because of high rotational barrier. And the two benzene rings in biphenyls are perpendicular to each other when the ortho groups are bulky. So when the ortho groups are bulky in biphenyls, the two rings cannot remain in the same plane. They have to be in the in different planes. In fact, they are perpendicular to each other because of steric hindrance. And when they are perpendicular to each other, and the molecule can have, if they are symmetrically substituted, you can have two symmetric planes. If they are unsymmetrically substituted, there will be no disymmetric plane in the molecule. So in such compounds, in biphenyls, the two rings are in perpendicular planes, and if either ring is symmetrically substituted, the molecule will have a plane of symmetry. So if any of these rings, I have shown here these biphenyls, ortho substituted biphenyls, this is ring A and this is ring B. And ring A or ring B is perpendicular to ring A. It is because of, this ring A throws away this ring B into another plane because of the presence of these bulky groups at the ortho positions. So this is the mirror image of this molecule. This is the mirror image of this molecule. So this molecule is optically inactive because, both rings are symmetrically substituted. The condition is that both rings should be unsymmetrically substituted. So ring B is symmetrically substituted. In this case, ring B is symmetrically substituted, while as ring A is not symmetrically substituted because there is a chlorine atom at this position. So ring B is symmetrically substituted. A plane drawn perpendicular to the ring B contains all the atoms and groups in ring A, hence it is a plane of symmetry. So, because this ring B is symmetrically substituted means ortho positions have similar substituents, and if we draw a plane which is perpendicular to ring B, this plane will contain all the atoms and groups which are present in ring A. So it means this plane can divide this molecule into two equal halves, and as a result this is the plane of symmetry, and when the molecule has plane of symmetry, it means it cannot be chiral, because molecules which have plane of symmetry, they have superimposable mirror image. So the molecule in the previous slide is a chiral. Now take this example. Here both these rings are unsymmetrically substituted. And rotation about carbon-carbon single bond joining the two rings is prevented because of ortho bulky groups. It gives rise to high rotational barrier. This molecule has no plane of symmetry, and the molecule when it lacks plane of symmetry, it means it will be chiral. So isomers that can be separated only because rotation about single bonds is prevented or greatly slowed are called as atropisomers, and the phenomenon is known as atropisomerism. So all those isomers that can be separated because of the hindered rotation about single bonds or slowing down of this rotation, they are known as, these isomers are known as atropisomers, and the phenomena is known as atropisomerism. So biphenyls exhibit this atropisomerism because there is hindered rotation around carbon-carbon single bond. So the concept of atropisomerism is very clear to you. It is it is mandatory for four large groups in biphenyls. It is mandatory that there should be four groups so that the free rotation can be prevented. But if the groups are large enough, three groups or even two groups. So if groups are large enough, even three groups, or in certain cases even two groups, can hinder the rotation around this carbon-carbon single bond of two phenyl rings, and they can be resolved. In various molecules, the groups on the ortho positions are not large enough, so to prevent rotation, but greatly slows it down. So in various certain molecules, these the groups on ortho position, they are not large enough to prevent this rotation about this bond, but they can slow it down. So in these cases, optically active compounds can be prepared initially. So initially we can prepare them, but because of the the rotation about this carbon-carbon bond is it's slow, it is there, but it is slow. means one compound can get converted into another compound. So initially we can prepare optically active compounds, but slowly they undergo racemization. Racemization means, you know, one isomer gets converted into another, one enantiomer gets converted into other enantiomer on standing. So racemization takes place on standing. For example, this molecule, in which, you know, there are only three groups and the groups are not too much bulky. So the half-life of this molecule is 9.4 minutes. Means in 9.4 minutes, this molecule gets converted to its enantiomer. So it was about biphenyls. Alenes. You know, the central carbon in alenes is sp hybridized. Okay, the 2p orbitals on the central carbon, which are unhybridized, they are perpendicular to each other and each overlaps with the p orbital of one adjacent carbon, forcing the two remaining bonds of each carbon into perpendicular planes. So this is the structure of alenes. So, you know, in the next slide, which I have shown here, you can clearly see this is the structure of general structure of alenes. Alenes are CH2, double bond CH, double bond CH2. They have cumulative double bonds. This is known as an alene. This is the simplest alene. The central carbon here, it is sp2 hybridized. It's sp hybridized, as I have shown here. Being sp hybridized, it has two unhybridized p orbitals, and these two unhybridized p orbitals can overlap with the neighboring p orbital of these carbons, but which is sp2 hybridized. Both of these carbons are sp2 hybridized. It means that these outer carbons have one orbital, unhybridized orbital, p orbital. But since this central carbon, which is sp hybridized, one p orbital is py and the another orbital is pz, it means that these two orbitals on central carbon are, you know, they will overlap with the py orbital of, suppose, this carbon and the pz orbital of this carbon. So it means that this pi bond, which central carbon makes with the, this carbon, will be perpendicular to the double bond which it makes with this carbon. So, you know, the molecule adopts a perpendicular shape. That perpendicular shape is shown here. This is the perpendicular shape. Means this double bond is perpendicular to this double bond. And as a result, these CH2s also become perpendicular. So you know, the not only are the two pi bonds perpendicular, but the two methylene groups are also perpendicular. So this is the orbital structure here, complete orbital structure. You can see it in, you know, in the next slide. I have shown, you know, the complete orbital structure. You can easily see it. These are the two new pi bonds. These are the two new pi bonds which this central carbon makes with these outer carbons. And this pi bond is perpendicular to this pi bond. It is clear. They are perpendicular to each other. Right? It means that these CH2s here, they are perpendicular to these CH2s. Means these CH, you know, this CH and H, they are perpendicular to this CH and H because of sp hybridization of central carbon. So these hydrogens are perpendicular to two hydrogens on outer side. So this is the molecular structure of these, orbital structure of these alenes. So, you know, thus alenes have two disymmetric planes because of sp hybridization of the central carbon, as I have shown you how these disymmetric planes are formed, like biphenyls. And like biphenyls, alenes show chirality only if both sides are unsymmetrically substituted. So the end carbons in alenes have to be unsymmetrically substituted if these compounds have to exhibit optical activity or chirality. For example, this molecule here, you know, these two carbons, this carbon and this carbon, both these carbons are unsymmetrically substituted, and this CAA is perpendicular to C dash A dash B dash. They are in perpendicular planes. Both these carbons are unsymmetrically substituted. It means that this molecule will have no plane of symmetry. When it has no plane of symmetry, it means that this molecule will be optically active. This one, both carbons should be unsymmetrically substituted, but they are not. This carbon is this one. It is symmetrically substituted. This is also symmetrically substituted. So both carbons are they are symmetrically substituted. They should be, they should be unsymmetrically substituted. But here they are symmetrically substituted, so this molecule is optically inactive. We call this molecule as, it is optically inactive, this molecule. What about this? This is also optically inactive because this carbon is symmetrically substituted and this carbon is unsymmetrically substituted. So at least if one carbon is symmetrically substituted, the molecule will have plane of symmetry. Both carbons have to be unsymmetrically substituted. Take this example. Now this molecule is optically active because both carbon and carbons are optically, they are unsymmetrically substituted, and as a result there will be no plane of symmetry and this molecule will show optical activity. There is a important note: when a molecule has 3, 5 or any odd number of cumulative double bonds, orbital overlap causes the 4 groups to occupy one plane, and cis trans and not enantiomerism is possible. It means that this atropisomerism is not possible in those allenes which contain 3, 5 or any odd number of cumulative double bonds. You have to keep this thing in mind, that this optical activity or chirality is not shown by those allenes which contain 3, 5 or any odd number of cumulative double bonds, because in those orbital overlap causes 4 outer groups to occupy one single plane. They have to be in different planes, and as a result cis trans isomerization can arise but not enantiomerism. Means odd double bond allenes do not have disymmetric planes, hence they are optically inactive. This thing you have to keep in mind. Well, as if 4, 6 or any even number of cumulative double bonds are there, the situation is similar to an alkene, to an allene, if even number of cumulative double bonds are present. So the situation is similar to an allene, and optical activity is possible provided both outer carbons are unsymmetrically substituted. Like this is optically active compound. So this is about allenes, how they show optical activity. Now spiro compounds are spirans, they are called. What are spiro compounds? If both the double bonds in allenes are replaced by ring systems, right, the resulting molecule is known as a spiro compound. It's very easy. So if you replace 2 double bonds in allenes by 2 ring compounds, the resulting molecule is a spiro compound or spiran. Like this, these are 2 ring compounds, so they are known as spirans or spiro compounds. So they are similar to allenes and can show optical activity in unsymmetrically substituted, if they are unsymmetrically substituted. It is if here, if they are unsymmetrically substituted, means the rings which are perpendicular to each other, these 2 rings are perpendicular to each other, these 2 rings, the 2 rings here, they are perpendicular to each other, these 2 rings, this ring and this ring, they are perpendicular to each other, and hence, like those 2 double bonds in allenes, they are perpendicular to each other, and hence can exist in 2 enantiomers if they are unsymmetrically substituted. So the condition is same in all these compounds. Symmetrical substitution is needed. So this molecule is optically active because these groups are unsymmetrical. Same is the case, it's also optically active. So this is about spirans or spiro compounds. They have the same criteria as allenes. So fourth type is There's a term called helical chirality or chirality due to helical shape. You know, there are various compounds which have shown to be chiral because they have a helical shape, like, you know, DNA, which has a helical shape, or, you know, RNA, it also has a helical shape. DNA is a double helical shape. So, because they have a helical shape, and therefore they can be left-handed or right-handed in orientation. So anything which has a left-handedness or right-handedness, they have a potential to exist as two forms or two enantiomers. The entire molecule is usually less than, you know, less than one full turn of the helix. An example is, you know, trans-cyclooctene. Trans-cyclooctene shows helical chirality because the carbon chain must lie above the double bond. This carbon chain here from both sides, you know, the carbon chain, they should lie, both carbon chains, or we can say one carbon chain must lie above the double bond on one side and below it on the other side. So this is trans-cyclooctene. And this trans-cyclooctene can exist as it, because it has a helical shape, and this can act as, you know, exist as, this is R enantiomer, R negative, means this is R configuration, and this is S configuration. So they can exist as enantiomers, means they can show chirality. Another example of helical chirality is hexahelicine. This is another example. It has a helical shape, and you know, these two rings here, these two rings, they seem to be joining to each other, but they are not joining. You know, the molecule has helical shape, so these two rings here, they are little bit, you know, in different planes because of the helical shape. Maybe this is upside, this is slightly downside. So they have a helical shape. So this molecule, it can, because of this helical shape, it can show helical chirality. So this is known as helical chirality. So this is all for, you know, today's lecture. We will be back with the next lecture on stereochemistry. Till then, goodbye. Take care.